I know you saw the Supreme Court ruling last week. We preached on it last Sunday. Things are beginning to snowball more and more. Evil is prevailing. Our war is not on the foreign soil anymore. It's right here at home. And I'm talking about a spiritual warfare. And I believe now it's time that every Christian take a bold stand and stand boldly against this evil of our day. If we don't stand, it's going to crumble and it's going to fall, and it's going to fall hard. Amen. We must stand. We must stand. It's not going to be the preacher standing alone. It's going to take everyone who sits in those pews out there. Amen. Takes every one of us. It's not over. And it's not going to be over till Jesus comes. Amen. But we are God's voice. We are His people. And we just sung a song. When we had our veterans up, I'll stand up next to you and defend her still today. I think America is still worth defending. Amen. And the cores of America was built upon the moral issues of this book. Amen. And President Woodrow Wilson said this. He said, "A nation which does not remember what it was yesterday does not know what it is today, nor what it's trying to do. We are trying to do a futile or pointless thing if we don't know where we have come from or what we have been about." And when I look at history, I see that we were about God's business in America. We was about God's business. We took a stand on moral issues because God said He is a moral God and He is a godly God and He don't approve of wickedness activity. He is a holy. He said, "Be ye holy as I'm holy." Well, we've strayed far from God's principles, haven't we? We're saying everything goes, whatever you perceive truth to be, that's what truth is and that's what we should accept. Absolutely not. God is absolute truth, and that's what we shall accept. Amen. In America. Amen? I'm going to quote this as long as I got breath in my body, because Jesus said in John 14:6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh to the Father except by me." Amen. And so this book is our moral guide and truth. Amen. And it's absolute. So we got to remember where we come from to know where we're going in the future. Our founding fathers came, I believe, to come and grant us an opportunity to worship freely the Most High God. That's why they came to America. And you can't change my point of view on that no matter how you try. I believe it's founded in all our documents. You know, it mentions God, and God was the primary reason of the founding of this nation. And I believe that, amen, with all my heart. I wish they would teach it more in our public schools instead of the trash they're teaching today. Amen. Now, since I brought up the public schools, I don't know how many of you are very aware of what's taking place in the Commonwealth of Virginia, but in Fairfax County, they had the school board up there voted 10-2 to accept gender identity teaching in the public schools. They're going to teach your children everything that's immoral. All the sexual activities from incest on down. Gender teaching means that, you know, we got to have to find out what kind of gender you are. Well, I believe God still makes them male and female, and you don't have to guess at it. Hello? God made them male and female. "For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they shall become one." Throughout the whole scriptures, from Genesis to Revelation, that's God's design. God knew what gender you was when He made you and created you. He knows. And you don't have to second guess Him. He knows what He's doing. If God can put this universe together and make it so magnificent that the eye can't absorb all the beauty, then He knows how to make you and me. So if we don't know where we're going, come from, we don't know where we're going, And Douglas MacArthur, he noted, no nation in history which lost its moral or culture core was able to recover from the decline. And that is very true. If we continue to decline like we are in America, we'll never recover. We'll never recover. We'll never regain the ground again. You know, we preached it for years. Dr. Falwell preached it, others before. We preach where we are today, and the church sat silent. But we cannot sit silent any longer. You cannot sit on your pews on Sunday morning, then go back out of the door expecting next Sunday is going to be the same way, because next Sunday could be quite different. I believe it's coming a time there in America where you are going to be very clearly identified as a Christian, as a believer in Christ, or an unbeliever. Those who sit on our pews week in and week out sometimes hadn't had a personal relationship with God, and so they don't know which way to go. And my friend, today is a good day to check up, see where you're standing. Amen. Know who you believe in and why you believe in Him. So you don't have to be second-guessed. Oh man, it just boils my blood when preachers supposed to know the truth, they're standing behind the sacred desk and supposed to be preaching the truth, are second-guessed what God said. I don't have to second-guess God, and you don't have to second-guess God. God said what He means what He says. It's not up for private interpretation on some of the Scriptures. Hello? God said it, and that settles it. And God said it's morally wrong for man to lay with man. He said it's wrong. No matter how you shake it up, how you spin it around, it's still wrong. And so we need to stick to what God says. Not what man's opinions are, but what God says. And if we don't stand up for it, then He's going to separate us. Amen. He said, my goat's on the left and my sheep's on the right. Amen. And I don't want to be no goat. Amen. Well, what's wrong with goats? Well, if you read the Scriptures, the goat's going to lose in the end. But the sheep's going to win in the end. Amen. And I'd rather have the good shepherd leading me than the hauling who don't care. I'd rather have the good shepherd. He said He'll care for His sheep. And He said they won't stand alone. I'll stand with them. In Ephesians 6, God says for us to put on the whole armor of God. And in all the armor of God that's listed there, Paul wrote, there's nothing to protect the back of the Christian, because the Christian should never back up. He should always press forward. Amen. And he presses in and he presses on. Amen. Because greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. Amen. My goodness. I mean, this is just an introduction. Just hang on. All right. Just hang on. In the past and present generation, we have seriously compromised our Christian values. Amen. And we have sinned as a nation. And as we shared with you from the verse in 2 Chronicles 7:14 last week, He said, if my people, because see, this moral decay didn't start in the Washington or the White House. It started in the home. It started in the home. When we started lowering our standards within our home, within our own personal lives, that's what I'm talking about. Then it became filtered in the home, and then later it came into the church, and then from the church it went to the nation. You think about it, and you go back and read how we got to where we are today. Is because it happened in the individual, then it happened in the home, it happened in the church, and then it happened in the nation. So God said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land. But God is not going to do this until His people get down on their knees and confess their sin. Amen. Their sin of what, preacher? Of compromise and lowering the standards of the Most High God in which they were supposed to uphold. So what must we do as America people, as a group of American people? What must we do in America? First of all, if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn to Jeremiah chapter 29. And we're going to be looking at verse 13. In Jeremiah 29, in verse 13, the Lord says this, that we must seek him. He said, "And he shall seek me and find me when he shall search for me with all your heart." I believe now is the time that we need to seek and find God once again in our lives, so we can put him in our home, so we can put him in our church, so we can put him in our nation. Amen. We need to seek God with all our heart, soul, mind, and body. If we as an individual seek God in that fashion, he said, "You will find me. You will find me when you have searched for me with all your heart." And when we find God, then God can be the light to this dark world that we're living in. Come on, let's give him the praise. Amen. He can be the light within us to this dark world that we're living in. But we got to seek him. We got to seek him. And I believe without a shadow of doubt, folks, it's going to start with prayer. Amen. A prayer of forgiveness. A prayer of sincere, heartfelt forgiveness and conviction. And when we pray and seek God in that fashion, God is going to, amen, forgive. And he's going to do a great work within us. Amen. I believe there's a great awakening awaiting. I believe what the Supreme Court did is a great evangelistic tool for the church if it would just grab a hold of holy boldness and seek God, ask for forgiveness, and get on the fire line and say, "Enough is enough. We're going to raise the bloodstained banner, and we're not going to give up." We got to have the determination in the gable end of our souls that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and Daniel had in their day. No matter what laws was passed, they wasn't going to compromise God's word. And they stood their ground, even in captivity, when they were surrounded by all the evil. They stood their ground. They didn't ask when God would show up. They knew he would show up. If they stood up, he would show up. Glory to God. But God is good. And he's a good God. And he's worthy to fight for. Because if we fight for him, he'll fight for us. Amen. Man, I don't know how I got on these Hebrew boys, but amen, while I'm here, I'm going to just tell you. Old Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego said, "You go ahead and do what you want to do." Amen. They made them so mad they heat the furnace 7 times hotter than it was supposed to be. Amen. And they threw them, supposed to devour them, but it devoured the men that threw them in. Yeah. The king looked into the furnace. And you talk about cremation. That's what they was going to do. Cremate these old Hebrew boys. But when the king looked into that furnace, they were walking around in the flame. I got joy like a river. I got joy. No fire was touching them. And he says, "You know, did we not cast 3 into the fiery furnace?" He said, "I see the fourth one. He looks like to me as a son of man." Amen. God himself.
Oh, yeah. Amen.
God himself showed up. Woo! I wish God show up in the beginning this morning.
Oh, yeah. Amen.
I wish God would show up, amen, on the White House steps, amen, this morning.
Amen.
When is he going to show up? It's when God's people start standing up. America needs to know God is real. He's not dead.
Amen.
He is real, and he's real in my heart. He's real in my soul. He's real all over me. Glory to God. Amen.
Amen.
Because I can feel him deep inside of me.
Oh, yeah.
Amen. Oh, sometimes, amen, he blisters my britches. Do you know what I'm talking about? I mean, he tears me up. Amen. When I'm wrong, I'm wrong. And I got to admit that I'm wrong. And I believe, amen, in America, if you seek God, God's people will seek him and forget, amen, on their knees and say, forgive me, God. Amen. Praise God. He'll light a fire in your soul.
Amen.
It wasn't denying, amen, when they brought them Hebrew boys out of that furnace. It wasn't no denying that God was on their side.
Amen.
But they come walking out of there with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We're going to walk out of this world one day with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Amen. Yes, we are. Mm-hmm. Amen.
But not until we make a stand.
Amen.
To let God's voice be heard. So everyone will have the opportunity to repent from their wicked ways.
Amen. Yes.
So they can spend eternity with him.
So
they can spend eternity with him.
Amen.
So what is America to do? It's to seek God.
Amen. Yes.
To seek God. Seek him. Let's read it again. And he shall seek me and find me when he shall search for me with all your heart.
Amen.
All your heart. And if we don't seek him, I'm going to give you the warning that Amos gave us in chapter 4 and verse 12. Prepared to meet their God. Prepare to meet their God. That can be taken two ways. We need to prepare to meet him, get our hearts right with him, or we're going to prepare to meet him in judgment. Because God said in his word, and last week we looked at this in Romans chapter 1 and verse 18, the wrath of God is revealed against all ungodliness. The wrath of God is revealed. That means he's going to expose his wrath. And you better be prepared.
Amen.
It's going to come, just like he said. Amen. If we don't change from our wicked ways, we're going to see God's wrath poured out more and more on America.
Yeah.
So it's time now that we seek him. Seek him with all our heart. And I believe the next thing we need to do, we must recognize the undisputable rights of absolute truth. God is truth. We have a right, we need to have right living, right thinking, right solution, right principles, which are all found in this book we call the Bible. Right living, right thinking, right principles, all are found right here in God's eternal truth.
Amen.
Don't you like to think right? Think right. Do right. Do right, do right, family. Yeah. I don't know where that would come from anyhow, but anyhow. Thought I'd throw that in there. Second, we must recognize America's obligation to the Creator.
Amen.
The one we originally recognized in our Declaration of Independence. Isn't it amazing that those founding fathers even put God in that? I don't think God is a part of this founding fathers. They didn't know who God was. Yes, they did.
Oh, yeah.
They did know who God was, and they knew we wouldn't survive without him.
Right.
And America will not survive without God. America will not survive without God.
Amen.
So don't let this crowd tell you that we can eliminate God and still be successful as a nation. We will not. God has blessed America. It's not the American people. It is God who's blessed us. Because the American people honored God. And when they honored God, God honored them. Made them successful businessmen and women and leaders. And when you eliminate him, then his blessings will be removed and you'll fall and you'll fall hard.
Amen.
Prime example is the third world nations who no longer acknowledge God. You see them falling every day. You see them falling every day. But if we're going to survive, we got to seek God with all our heart. We got to recognize the undisputable right of absolute truth. And we must recognize American obligation to our Creator and the one we have mentioned in our Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, rather. We must recognize that every American has equal right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And somehow or another, they throw this out when they talk about our unborn. The baby in the womb has a right to live.
Amen.
just as you had a right to live. Isn't it amazing that all of them who approves of abortion are already living, already been born? What if the story was different? What if they was in the womb and somebody wanted to take their life? They'd be hollering, oh, no, no, everybody has a right to live. Amen. Just saying. Just an eye-opening. And I think not only we need to do all of those things that we just talked about, but we must repent of our sins and rebellion most of all. We must forsake the pursuit of selfish pleasures. And we must confess our national sin and recognize that our national sin will bring God's judgment on this nation. And the last thing, we must restore hope. Because it's not all doom and gloom yet, because we still got God's people here in the land. Are you God's people? Do you have hope? What is your hope in? That somebody in the White House or Congress or in Richmond is going to change? What is your hope in? If it's in God, then let God be God in you. Let God be God in you. And let America know there is hope. If we are turned from our wicked ways, God will bring hope to and peace to our land again. Amen. He will bring peace. But we must seek Him with all our heart. Amen. We must seek Him with all our heart. We must recognize His absolute truth. He is absolute. And without Him, there's no absolute rights or wrongs. And if we don't heed to absolute truth, folks, it's going to continue a downward spiral. Because see, the world says there's no absolutes. But God said there is. There is absolute rights and wrongs. There is absolute. And we must heed to that. And we must recognize American obligation to our Creator, the one we recognized in the Declaration of our Independence. We must recognize that every American has equal right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And we must repent of our sin and rebellion as an individual. And then we must confess our national sin. And then we must restore hope to our nation again. Will you help me? Will you stand up next to me and defend her still today? Even if it causes you a great deal? The Hebrew boys, Daniel. Daniel was thrown in the lion's den because he defied the law that you couldn't pray in public. He said, God said, pray. And men always ought to pray, Jesus said in Luke 18:1. Daniel wasn't about to shut down his prayer life just because there was a law passed. And let me tell you something this morning, church. I'm not about to stop preaching against the wrong, even though a law has been passed. Daniel threw open his windows and he prayed 3 times a day like he always prayed. Amen. They come and arrested him, took him, threw him in the den of lions. Get my tongue twisted here. Den of lions. But you know, that was the first electric blanket. It was alive. The next morning, Daniel was found sleeping with the lions that were supposed to eat him. God kept him warm in a heated blanket. And guess what? The same lions that he slept with devoured the men that came about to the king with this law. And the old lions looked at Daniel and said, thank you, thank you, thank you. And thank the Lord for this great meal he provided. Just a thought. Amen. But God can do great things if we honor him. But it's got to start with us. It's got to start with us. we as an individual must seek God. So will you seek Him this morning as we stand to our feet? Would you join around this altar and just pray? Pray as an individual. Ask God to, anything in your life that shouldn't be there, forgive you, help you to restore hope in America again. Most of all, starting in your home. Then as you grow in your home, filter it to your community, and to your church, and to your nation. Let it begin with me today. Let the spark begin right here so a fire, a revival can sweep across our land. Our Heavenly Father, God, as I come to you today, Lord, I thank you, God, for the words that we've heard today, and thank you for the songs that have been sung. And Father, you have spoken to your hearts of your people already. And Father, I just ask today, Lord, that you continue to deal with each individual as to what you would have them to do in this day that we're living in. That once again, we can bring hope to our nation. That Father, when we get up here next year, we can say thank you, not for 239 years, but another 240 years, because we stood our ground, and we even though it seemed like we was losing, we began to win. And Father, we will be winners in the end when all is said and done. But may we stand boldly while we're here, without compromise, and God, without shame. And Father, we'll love you, we'll praise you for all you accomplish, in Jesus' name. Friend, if God has spoken to your heart, will you join me around this altar and pray for yourself, pray for your family, pray for your nation?